The 6800 XT from AMD is finally here at $650 featuring 16 gigabytes of VRAM. Is it going to dethrone the RTX 3080, which was Nvidia's $700 4K gaming champion? Well, there's only one way to find out. Let's roll those benchmarks for you guys, where we've got 1080p, 1440p, and 4K numbers.
On a distant planet, somewhere in the cosmos, we exist in cyberspace. Transported to the future. We're dealing with forces beyond our control. You will be terminated.
So the numbers are all out, and what we saw there was just an absolute show of performance. AMD, with their 6800 XT, they've really evolved. And that's the best word to say from coming from me, because I've just seen them over the years. They've struggled to compete with Nvidia, especially on the high end. I mean, the last real card that I was enthusiastic from AMD was the RX 400 and 500 series, but with the high-end side of things, they didn't really throw Nvidia a high-end flaming fist of fury. And sort of like their high-end, say for instance, Vega and then Radeon 7, they were met with a bit of, I guess, power consumption, and then they had water coolers, and there was a few things that stopped them from really just competing on the high-end over the years. But this right here, the 6800 XT, marks a new level of price performance, but also a new level of top performance, where depending on the title, 1080p, a lot of the times they're going to be CPU bound. And in today's testing, I did use a 5800X. I did overclock that and also use that with 32 gigabytes of CL18 3800 megahertz memory. So we got the best performance numbers out of both the Nvidia card and the AMD card over PCIe Gen 4. Now, in terms of the 1440p numbers, here's where I'm going to be making a solid recommendation for the 6800 XT. it's pulling ahead of the 3080 comfortably on average at this resolution. Now, if you're a high refresh rate 1440p gamer or you're an ultra wide gamer, this card is going to offer you really good value for money in the high end segment. And we'll talk about value for money on the lower end segment later on. But when it came to the 4K numbers, this is where they started to even out a bit, and it did start to favor the 3080 because of the GDDR6X. And although it's only got 10 gigabytes of 6X, this stuff is faster than the GDDR6 that they're putting on the RX 6800 XT. Even though you get 16 gigabytes and more VRAM, you do get faster VRAM on the 3080, hence why the 1440p numbers will favor the 6800 XT versus the 4K numbers, which will generally favor the 3080. Though as for the power consumption, here's where these two cards are going head to head yet again. The 6800 XT being on 7 nanometer and then the 3080 being on 8 nanometer, I was expecting the power consumption to be, I guess, in the same ballpark, but they were pretty much identical when I was testing Dirt 4 at 4K, where the difference was only a couple of watts. And then when I started to undervolt the 6800 XT, it started to perform very similar as an undervolted 3080. And this was really surprising because you will definitely want to undervolt the 6800 XT in my opinion, because we then got around 90 watts less power consumption from the wall, where the 3080 got similar results when I was undervolting that. And you're only losing a couple of FPS at best. So if you want to save power, and also the benefit to that too is better longevity on your GPU, as well as running a lower noise and a cooler temp on your card, then undervolting is definitely going to be something you'll want to check out. Now with that said, I will be making an undervolting tutorial for both these cards coming out very soon, so do stay tuned for that. Though as for the build quality and the cooler on the 6800 XT, we did do a dedicated unboxing video where I did talk about how I was very impressed with the build quality of the 6800 XT and AMD's reference design this time around. Now, pulling up the numbers here shows that the auto fan speeds out of the box are the quietest out of the four configurations that I test here, but then I also test manual 60%, 80%, and 100% fan speeds. And the temperatures I found were actually best at 60% manual fan speeds. And now the ambient temperatures where I am are pretty hot at the moment. We are starting to go towards summer, whereas the rest of the world is going into winter. But I feel like that's a good thing because it's kind of giving out a worst case scenario on how this cooler will perform in a lot of situations. So the cooler did hold up. It was starting to get a little bit on the hot end of things. But again, if you undervolt, you will get lower temperatures and better noise. But what about the ray tracing performance now? This is something that AMD were touting, that they've got DirectX ray tracing support with RDNA 2. The consoles are going to get that as well. They use RDNA 2 as well. And here's where I saw that the ray tracing performance was behind that of the 3080. I did think that it did look a bit better on the 3080, and I have seen other comparisons where the 3080 ray tracing performance is looking a bit better, as well as performing a bit better than the RDNA 2 solution. Though we definitely know that NVIDIA have been working on ray tracing for a couple of years now, so it's no surprise to see that they are ahead in that segment for now at the very least. And I did test out the ray tracing performance in numbers in terms of World of Warcraft, where AMD said, look, take a look at the ray tracing shadows. Though I didn't notice a whole lot of difference in visual fidelity, and I'll pull up a side-by-side for you guys, but I did notice a massive performance drop at 4K, where I did max out the settings here all the way to the max 10 slider. And the good news is that pretty much all the cards in the graph here will give you a 4K 120 hertz experience, which if you want to couple it with an OLED at 4K, this card, as well as the NVIDIA cards, will do a great job on World of Warcraft. With the new expansion coming out, I'm sure there's going to be some people out there that want to get an OLED and just really enjoy the game, especially at a smooth frame rate. Though on that note of OLED, we'll quickly interlude here. What about the OLED support in terms of the 4K 120 hertz? Here is where I noticed that we were getting 120 hertz unlocked, though I did have some problems with the variable refresh rate. It wasn't working quite properly just yet. When I tested out two different games, Dota 2 and also CSGO, it was not really adhering to the syncing, and it was just going pretty much unlimited FPS. So they do have to implement a driver update, and maybe LG will have to implement a firmware update to get the 120 hertz working properly, whereas the 3080 has had a few months and that is working perfectly at the moment. And it's not just the frame rate and the G-Sync and the FreeSync, it's also the HDR 10-bit support. It isn't working 100% on the 6800 XT just yet, though I'm sure AMD will get on that with the drivers. Though, speaking of the drivers, this is where we'll segue into that, because the drivers aren't perfect on day one, and I'm going to give AMD, just like I gave NVIDIA the benefit of the doubt, I'm going to give AMD the benefit of the doubt here and just say, look, the drivers will get better, but I did notice some things that I would like to see AMD improve on that note. Where at this point in time, they pretty much give you the Radeon software, and then it's got all these options that it's feature packed. But the problem is, every time I load it up to do one specific thing, I don't want to go through a menu with all these fancy transitions, all these fancy graphs and text. I just want to, say, for instance, lock in an undervolt profile, and I want to do that quickly and easily, which is what MSI Afterburner do. So I'd like to see AMD offer a minimalist install on their Radeon driver package and allow full unlock control to programs like Afterburner, where when I was trying to undervolt and overclock as well, I was just met with a fan profile that took 10 minutes to ramp up to those fan speeds. So if I locked in manual 80%, I had to just AFK my computer and then wait until it finally slowly ramped up to that. And that also happened in the Radeon software itself. So on that note, the driver experience was solid from day one, but the user experience could definitely be improved on with certain things like that. Now, what about the encoder? Thanks, Brian from the past. And I actually did more analysis after the recordings from the three GPUs. And you guys, even asked you guys on Twitter, and what you said that was unanimous that the center image looked the worst. And that was actually the 6800 XT's encoder with Dirt 5. And this was all 4K Ultra. The 5700 XT, you guys said it was actually looking the best majority of the times. And then some people said the left-hand side, which was the NVIDIA 3080, looked the best sometimes. So it was a majority on the 5700 XT, however, in this game, and this was done through Streamlabs high quality MP4. So that is an efficient way of recording videos, as opposed to using the in-house GeForce Experience versus even AMD's Relive 2. So it's a practical solution, and out of the practicality way of doing things, the 6800 XT's encoder looks like it was the worst. Something to take note on. Back to you, past Brian. Though finally, with all that aside, if you're watching up until this point and you haven't pre-ordered one of these 6800 XT's yet, then I feel like they're gonna be sold out. And I feel like it's gonna follow the same problem the 3080 did, especially the 3080, where this card was my favorite pick out of the 3000 series coming in, and coming out, it was even then more so my favorite pick, because I thought it was the most relevant card on the high end. Coming out of it, I haven't tested the 6900 XT or the 6800, but coming into it, looking at the results and the specs that AMD were providing, I liked the 6800 XT, and AMD said, which card do you want to check out? And I requested the 6800 XT, and I am not disappointed one bit. They really blew my expectations away 110% with this card. Now, if you're into ray tracing and you want to get things like DLSS with ray tracing on, NVIDIA do have that side of things polished. The RTX Studio driver set, I have found, and I did edit some videos on the 6800 XT, and I found that this was working better with CUDA support in Adobe Premiere Pro with the RTX Studio driver. So if that's anything to go by, one I feel is more suited up towards raw value price performance gaming as it stands, because I mean, we can come back and look at this in a couple of months time once AMD's perfected their driver, but as it stands, if I was into raw value for money gaming, getting the best price performance possible without turning on ray tracing and extra fluff, then this is going to work really well. Though if I was more focused on the other things that I spoke about, the studio driver set and also getting a better user experience, I would go for the 3080. Though I will say this before we transform and roll out of here, and that is, if you're going for either one of these cards, a 6800 XT or a 3080, you are not going to be disappointed. They're both really good cards, and I think that the 6800 XT is definitely going to have stock issues, just like the 3080, and the 3080 still has stock issues months on. It's like, at least from the retailers I'm speaking to locally here, this is the most in-demand card versus the 3070 versus the 3090. So I'm guessing the 6800 XT is going to be very quickly sold out, and it's going to be back ordered as well. Now, some last minute things as well. Two little last minute things. Crypto mining benchmarks, terrible on this card, at least from what I tested here. 60 mega hashes per second. The 5700 XT, and I think the Radeon 7 beats it out too. So whatever AMD's done here, and I did speak to them, I was like, guys, is the cryptocurrency performance meant to be this bad? And they said this time around, they wanted the gamers to get the cards. So maybe that means that they've done something with the drivers, or they've done something on a hardware level, but they have nerfed the crypto performance relative to the game performance on the 6800 XT. Also the rage mode, I did turn that on and I thought that it was just giving a little bit extra, but the power consumption went up. So I just decided to test with out of the box settings. The rage mode didn't do anything for me personally, where I was impressed with more so the power consumption and the noise with the out of the box. And of course the overclocking, the undervolting manually did much better. Then there's the final thing, the smart access memory. They AMD said, look, take a look at the smart access memory for us. And I just said, guys, it's really beta at this stage, because they wanted me, just like the review initially of the Zen 3, they wanted me to test on a very specific BIOS on a very specific motherboard. So I'm gonna let that mature and then I'll take a look at smart access memory in the future, because I just don't wanna be a beta tester at this point in time. Let's get on now to the question of the day, but do let us know in the comment section below, which one of these would you be picking? Would you be picking 6800 XT or the 3080? Love reading your thoughts and opinions, though I did say earlier in the video I was going to talk about the lower end, and I'm hoping that both Nvidia and AMD do bring out something to address, say, the $200 price point, where we're getting, at least in relation to what these provide, that price performance where I feel like 1080p gamers, especially on a budget, could really benefit from this new tech. So please Nvidia, please AMD, get us something on this lower end side of things, because there's nothing really in sight for the immediate future. The question of the day, Sodomaniac. They ask, where did the comments you were answering go? Question mark. And this is on a video that we did, like my first video on a Razer Abyssus ages ago. And I think back in that time, there was no reply feature. It just tagged the user. So when you're seeing all these comments on an old video in a row, it's just how the old YouTube system worked, as opposed to, I think a few years ago, maybe I don't know when they exactly implemented it, but then they implemented a direct reply feature so the comments were more structured. So hopefully that answers that question. And with that aside, I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.